1 minute left, so if somebody had spoken in your pair, they're speaking now. Not quite as it seems. Okay, one more question and then I'm going to go into it.
Sorry.
Yeah?
It comes from our minds, it's the imagination. It's
everything is, we create our own reality.
It's a representation of an exchange of energy. So we go out, we work, we get paid for that time and energy that we've invested in our employer. And as a representation of that, it's expressed in a financial transaction. Yeah.
Great contributions. Okay, one more question is, what is quantitative easing? I know, I don't know. It's a horrible word. Well, it's two words. What is quantitative easing? I know, I don't know. Okay, we'll ask somebody who's, who, everyone's spoken, I think. Have you spoken?
Quantitative easing is making it easier for banks to lend money. So for people to get access to money with the banks hold a lower reserve in order to be able to lend out more. And so the Bank of England makes that possible for the banking system to do. That's quantitative easing.
Great, thank you. And I'll go into it a bit more in detail later. So thanks very much for everyone who joined. Let's have a round of applause for the energetic people. I think just from that quick discussion, you can see that we can think about money on many different levels, whether that's economics, sociology, maths, philosophy, and it's quite a kind of amorphous thing and an intangible thing. That's what I'm going to talk about for the next kind of 20 minutes. So I think there was some differences of opinion, but essentially I think most people in the room feels like money is power in our current society. We've allowed it to become that. But I just want to take a few minutes to talk about what is money, because I think it's a really big question that very few people ask themselves. I certainly have never thought about it before I came across positive money. And it's essentially a tool. And like most tools, it was, you know, invented by humans to make our lives easier. But it seems, you know, in modern day, it makes most people's lives more difficult. There's a proverb that says, the fish is the last to know water. And I feel like it's a bit the same with money. We're in a society where we're surrounded by money, we're swimming in money, everything is dependent on money, everything seems to be connected to money, but few of us think about where it comes from or how it really works. And that's what we want to talk about today. But it's, at its most useful, it's a means of payment. So we use it to buy our clothes, our food, our shelter, and that's actually really, really useful. And you know, some people have said it's more useful than fire or even a wheel. It is a useful invention. But anthropologists like David Graeber have looked at how we've got into the situation we've got in today, and they've studied small communities from thousands of years ago who didn't need any money because they could exchange things based on trust, basically. You cook your friend some fish for dinner, and you know they're going to repay the favor in a week's time. But as these communities started to grow, there wasn't quite that level of trust. It was all getting a bit complicated, too many relationships. So they started recording things. They'd record who was the debtor and who was the creditor. But obviously that's still quite complicated because you still need to have a relationship with the debtor in order to get your fish or whatever it was that you needed back off them. And that could result in quite a few fights in the communities and disputes. And so actually trust starts breaking down. So they needed to come up with another invention to kind of allow things to be, a means of exchange to be a bit easier, rather than this like complex mix of tangled relationships. And that's when money really arose. So the idea is that you can have some kind of token, so you don't need to remember who owes you stuff. You can just exchange based on, you know, I buy this from you, I give you the token. You don't have to return the token to me. You can then go and spend it. And obviously where we know money took off really well is where people started to use precious metals, basically. And the problem with precious metals were obviously they were precious, so they contained a value in of themselves. And so people didn't necessarily want to kind of keep them in their own kind of under the mattress. So that's when banks arose. Basically, they're like, we'll keep your tokens, your precious metals safe, and in return, we'll give you an IOU slip. And obviously, then people could just exchange the IOUs from the banks as money. They didn't need to have the precious metals. And so what happened then is obviously the banks realized they can just create a lot more IOUs than they have precious metals. And that really laid the kind of foundations of the modern banking system we have today. And I guess the point is that this money system we've had goes on, you know, hundreds of thousands of years back, and it's been problematic kind of throughout history. It's not a new phenomenon. I think I'll leave it there. So that's kind of how modern money and banking came about. It wasn't really through anyone thinking it through. It's just kind of evolved, and it was meant to be useful. So who has the power to create money? We heard a few different ideas earlier, and you're both right. So in the UK, in terms of who creates the notes and coins, it is the Bank of England and the Royal Mint that creates the cash that we use. But that's not very much of the money we use anymore. The vast majority exists in numbers in a computer system. It's like electronic money, digital money. And the people that create that is, like the gentleman over there said, it's commercial banks when they make loans. So when you or I go into a bank and take out a mortgage, it's in London of like £400,000, that £400,000 didn't exist until the point at which you take out a loan. And the bank then creates money out of nothing, and at the same time a debt. It's an IOU, basically, to the bank. And you don't have to believe me, because why is this important? So this is important because understanding of money and how it's created has disappeared from economics textbooks over the last kind of few decades. And this is confirmed by the Bank of England in 2014, when they said, contrary to most, the way money creation is taught in most economics textbooks, and by most they mean pretty much all, money is actually created by commercial banks when they make loans. Here's a quote from the paper. So commercial banks create money in the form of bank deposits by making new loans. So that's quite important, because we really need to, if we're going to get a grip on money, if we're going to really have a socially just money and banking system, we need to understand money, we need to understand how it's created and where it goes. So most of the money exists as bank deposits, and some exists in notes and coins, which is created by the central bank, and that's kind of the only public money that we have. And it's 97% of all the money we have is created by banks lending, and now only 3%. So it's a much smaller amount. Just looking at that through time, we can see that there's obviously been a massive expansion of money created by banks, especially running up to the financial crisis, where you can see at the peak it's like £2.3 trillion. And at the same time, we can see a massive amount of debt increasing. So this is the situation we've got, is that banks create these IOUs, which is the digital money, when they make loans. And that's almost all the money we use. And notes and coins are created by the central bank. And so what do they do with that money? You know, is it created for society, or is it mostly for themselves? Well, I think we know intuitively that most money isn't flowing into people's pockets from the banks. And we can see that if we look at where they were lending in the 10 years up to the crash. So only 8% of all new loans went into what we call the real economy. And by real, we mean non-financial. And by financial, we mean finance, insurance, and real estate, or the fire sector. So fire bad, real good. So only 8%, went into the real economy. Really coming to in terms of business lending, a further 8% went to the real economy in terms of consumer loans, so high cost credit, people are struggling to pay just to get by, so they're having to take out loans. But then a massive 31% of lending went into the financial sector, and a massive 51% went into property markets. And you might think, hey, hang on a minute, it's good if it goes into property markets because more people can own their homes. I think that's a good thing. Actually, home ownership has been declining throughout the last 20 years, and it started declining really as the mortgage lending started booming. So actually, more mortgages doesn't mean more people owning their homes, it means less. So what does this mean in terms of the consequences? Okay, so I'm going to be talking about this like through the lens of money creation. So it's not to say like this is the truth of how the economy works. It's just to try and look at the economy through the lens of money creation. So feel free to challenge me on stuff is what I'm saying, basically.
I've got a question.
Yeah. So less home ownership, yeah, exactly. So there's lots of money being flowing into property markets, mortgage lending from banks. So the question was, is that because of buy-to-let? And exactly, so that's resulting in low home ownership because most of those mortgages are going towards people who are buying property to let it rather than people who are buying to live in it. Yeah. Yeah, can you allow for it?
When you're talking about money, you're talking about the imaginary money, aren't you? Because I look at money in two different states. The thing that has an actual real intrinsic value, like the gold dinar, let's say, for example, or the imaginary IOU money, which is what the whole world is trading on at the moment. So are you referring, when you're referring to money going in and out of box, it's the IOU money, isn't it?
Yeah, so we could get into a really big discussion around what is money and kind of, does it have to have intrinsic value? You're kind of saying, in your view, if it doesn't have intrinsic value, it's not real money. But I would say, so there's an economist called Minsky who said, money is not gold, it's trust inscribed. And I guess he was trying to get at, like, we decide what we believe is money, and if almost all of the money we use is kind of made-up money, money from the banks, but it's how we get by, it's how we buy food, it's how we pay our rent, it's how we buy clothes to wear, that isn't real money to most people, but we trust intrinsically the banks, or more accurately, we trust the government will bail out the banks or will keep the system going. And that's really what's holding this money system together. I'm going to take, because I feel like there's about 10 hands that have gone up, which is really great, but I feel like so that everyone gets a chance to speak, if I just carry on for like 10 minutes, and then we're going to break into groups, and I'm going to ask you
to think through a few questions and then feedback. Yeah. Get it accepted. Yeah. Well, I think that if I start, it's just going to be a waterfall effect. And there's so much knowledge and intelligence in this room. I'm not trying to shut anyone up. I just feel like actually it would be great to get through it and then we can all break out into discussion. Because there's so, like, it's a really rich topic and I'm just kind of explaining a sliver. But I'm just going to carry on and then we'll all get to chat and we'll all get to feed into a big discussion. Okay, so what are some of the consequences? As I said, I'm looking through a lens of money creation. So money is created by the banks, okay, when they make loans. That obviously leads to a lot of debt. It also leads to a massive amount of pumping of money into mortgages, which pumps up house prices, which also means that our household debt increases. And banks directly lending to households and businesses increases private debt. These things increase inequality. Higher house prices, we know, increase inequality. More debt means we are all paying interest on our money, which results in an inequality effect because what you find is the bottom 10th of society of income end up paying a much higher percentage of their income on interest than the top 10%, for example. There's a lot of ways in which this debt money system fuels inequality. High levels of debt and inequality, we know, help create the conditions for financial crises. The best indicator of a crash is coming is a build-up of private debt. And just so you know, the UK is predicted to be past its pre-crisis level of debt in 2020. So we're on the same trajectory of building up debt, which means that we're at a higher risk of financial crisis. Just a quote to back that up, Adair Turner was chairman of the FSA. He stepped in 2008, just after the crash. Financial crisis occurred because we failed to constrain the private financial system's creation of private credit and money. And this is just an academic study to say what I just said, which is basically they looked at 60% of the world's economy over 140 years. In that time, there's a load of financial crises, and they found the best predictor of a crisis was the rapid rise in debt just before. Private debt, bad. So that results in a recession because what happens, eventually the debt burden becomes too much, people start defaulting. When people start defaulting, banks panic, they stop lending, and that results into kind of a recession which can even tip into a depression. In a recession, very quickly people lose jobs because there's less economic activity, businesses and shops go bust. Obviously that results in more inequality, which we don't like. It also means that because more people are unemployed, then the government's debt goes up because we need to look after people through unemployment benefits. If we've got a mean government like we've had, they see the government debt going up, they do things like austerity, which makes the whole situation even worse. It increases inequality and it increases unemployment, and you get this negative loop. Also, financial crisis weaken government's ability to do what they were democratically elected to do because they're so focused on getting the economy going again, everything else goes out the window. And similarly, longer term plans such as environmental reforms, things that we need if we're going to kind of protect our environment and tackle climate change, go out the window. And it really means that whoever is in power is just focused on getting the economy going again at all costs and not really thinking more systemically. So there's a lot of bad things that happen after a financial crisis. And as I said earlier, Positive Money is one of very few organisations set up after the crash to challenge it. Okay, so I just want you to, I'm going to let you talk again to the person next to you. If you've already spoken to them, maybe move and try and speak to a new person. But just to kind of say what out of those things affects you the most right now, and then I'm going to ask for a couple of people's feedback. So just a couple more minutes. So if you haven't heard from someone in your power of three, please let them speak now. Okay. I can hear you're having some really great conversations. Is everyone having great conversations? Is anyone not having great conversations? Okay. Obviously, everyone's having a great conversation. Does anyone want to share with the group anything they thought that everyone else should hear, basically, anything they thought, oh, wow, yeah, that's really interesting, like, that's really important, take down here, and then the green T-shirt over there. So first of all, okay.
Yeah, I think we all kind of agreed that austerity was the linchpin in that picture, because if governments are implementing austerity policies, it actually feeds into everything else. The contraction of the economy means people are more likely to take on consumer debt. They're more likely to lose their jobs and require other sources of funding. It also means the government isn't doing anything about all of those other things either, because it's busy exacerbating them. And the people that are suffering the effects of that austerity are actually then less likely to be involved in dealing with any of the other issues either, because they're just trying to survive it. And, we all go a bit short-termist and, feed the kids, get their shoes, get their school uniforms, those types of issues, versus even being engaged enough in politics to actually start asking these kind of questions.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Hello. I think it doesn't come just from the banks. The banks will only lend if they think they're going to be getting some money back. And so I think that depends on a company or a corporation knowing it's going to be able to exploit workers to the extent they can make profits and pay the workers enough for them to get money back. So I think it's all of us that create the money. Workers create money. Work creates money under the capitalist system. And I think you should have profit take in your diagram somewhere, and it's quite an important thing that's missed out. So essentially, I think worker exploitation creates the wealth.
Does anyone else want to contribute what they were talking about in their group? And then I might just give a couple of reflections on those comments before I keep going.
Hello. Yeah, we were talking about how it was a problem basically with democracy, and the fact that the starting process of this whole chain is anti-democratic, really. There could be a conflict of interest involved within the creation of the money itself. When there is that conflict of interest, that creates this whole spiral of austerity in the first place. So, for example, if the Conservative Party have lots of bankers in the party or people in the party who have interests such as the creation of money, then it's a problem with democracy to start with.
Great. One more comment and then I'll keep going.
Well, we found that Bill and I both are at that stage of our lives where he's paid off his mortgage, I'm about to pay off my mortgage. We look quite pretty, but we're also quite old. And I'm starting to worry because there's absolutely zero forward planning for our care. If I sell my house, my London house, which is only, it's an ex-council terrace, and it's worth £500,000, a bit like Mr. Corbyn's house. It doesn't actually buy very much. It buys about 3 to 5 years of nursing care. And then what? And then what?
Yeah. And we also started on credit union, which I won't, we didn't get any
of that. Okay. Credit unions, brilliant things. We need more of them. Okay, so just a quick reflection on a couple of points. I think austerity obviously makes a really shit situation 10 million times worse. In terms of money being created just for like workers getting a wealth extraction point, work exploitation point, I think that's really important, and I feel like this doesn't really address many of the issues with our economy, but just to make a point as to why banks lend so much to property is because if you can't repay it, then you can default and they've still got the house. So there's a massive moral hazard in terms of where banks will lend. They won't lend to business, partly because of limited liability. If a business goes bust, then the bank doesn't get anything. So the whole system is actually weighted against any kind of real economy lending, and that's exacerbated by things like the Basel Accords and the capital adequacy ratios, which actually encourage banks to lend to mortgages. So it's all very, very flawed. And then I really like the points on democracy and on the house price inflation, but then costs like nursing home cost inflation as well just means that we're all screwed. Okay.
It's extremely brief. It's just I think we should make a clear distinction between, because I think it's a recurring theme that I can see that this happening again and again, we should make a distinction between money and wealth. They're not exactly the same thing. And we're confusing the terms, and that's why we're getting all confused and not understanding what it is that we're talking about. Wealth is one thing, goods, services, work, and then there is money. So the two separate things.
And I guess that's why I tried to do the little very brief history of money in terms of it is at its essence a means of payment, which is really a useful invention, but we've kind of lost that in amongst the massive inflation of the financial sector. Okay, so what do we want? What should we do about the power to create money? What do we want money in its kind of simplest form, a means of payment, to do? How do we want the system to work? We want something where it won't mean that house prices go sky high, it won't blow up housing bubbles, so that we can actually keep housing affordable. We want something that doesn't result in increasing levels of debt, which destabilizes the economy. We don't want something that automatically increases inequality, which automatically kind of ends up in a crash because we're all under so much debt, and therefore results in a recession, and therefore results in unemployment. We want something, a money system which doesn't undermine democracy. There was a really good point over there about moral hazard and links between banks and political parties. We want something which supports democracy, which helps to have a longer term vision for the economy, which does things like protect the environment and doesn't necessarily result in increased, like, massive amounts of government debt after financial crises. So how do we get there? Well, positive money's got quite a radical idea, which I won't spend much time to talking about because we've got a less radical idea, which is that actually we should just get rid of banks' power to create money. We need new types of banks, but we also need to cut out this kind of crazy system we've allowed to evolve over thousands of years. And actually, if we're going to have a national currency, then it should be created by a public institution, some kind of transparent, democratic, accountable body and in the public interest. And obviously, one thing we're trying to do is get this topic of money creation, which is quite a taboo topic, because it's disappeared from mainstream discourse and from economics, get it back into the public sphere. But how do we get there? So we heard a bit about
something called quantitative easing, and that's what I want to talk about now. So before 2008, basically the status quo was that banks create 97% of all the money. Then the crash happened, banks kind of froze up, were unwilling to lend. The state stepped in with something called quantitative easing, which is essentially when the Bank of England creates money out of nothing and uses it to buy financial assets, mostly government bonds from financial institutions. And what that does essentially is keep financial markets and stock markets pumped up, but there's very little for anyone else, and actually increases inequality. So Mervyn King, who was then the governor, said a damaged banking system means that today banks aren't creating enough money. We have to do it for them. So this is a kind of precedent of the state stepping in. So we know the state can create money. It is creating money through a horrible term of quantitative easing. But it's doing it in this very untransparent, you could say undemocratic way, which means that no one's really having a proper conversation about the fact that states are creating money and using it to flood financial markets. So in the USA, created £4.5 trillion, which is pretty crazy, between 2009-2015. In the UK, £375 billion. To put that into perspective, that's about half the amount the government spends in a year, so it is a lot of money. In Europe, £1.4 trillion, and in Japan, a similar amount. So it's happening all over the kind of big economies. But was it actually in the public interest? You know, these are central banks that can be held to public account, but because of they're so, I mean, we were having a conversation at the fringe event we did earlier, which was called the Bank of England under a Labour government, and the conversation we had there is like politicians don't want to hold central banks to account. They want to leave central banks to get on with it, but the point is what they're doing is having real consequences. So in the UK, we know that the £375 billion pushed up stock and bond prices and made the top 5% of households richer by £128,000. And the Bank of England's own research came up with this. So it's having direct effects that we can't ignore, political consequences. And just looking at whether it was in the public interest on the kind of other points we were talking about, then it actually resulted in house prices getting more expensive, and it actually aims to stimulate the economy, but by encouraging people and households and businesses to take on more debt, which we know risks financial stability. As I mentioned earlier, the best indicator of a crash is a build-up of private debt. As I pointed out just then, we know it increases inequality. And it actually has a minimal impact. I think the words have been used, like QE is actually meant to work by trickle down. So we pump loads of money into the financial markets, and we hope some will actually like trickle down into the real economy. But we know that that is a load of bullshit, and trickle down economics doesn't work, and it's never meant to work that way. And what actually happens is money gets stuck in financial assets, and it just inflates them more, and that's what's driving inequality. And it certainly hasn't led to any kind of longer term environmental thinking. In fact, it's ended up in money flooding into emerging economies, which has resulted in a lot of money entering like fossil fuel and extraction companies and industries. So we know it hasn't done good things for the environment, and the one good thing it does is it makes it slightly less for governments to borrow in the short term, but that in the long term isn't any good, because the interest will actually go up eventually, and I can talk more about that later if that's useful. Okay, so then this year we just decided to do it all over again. So 2016, Brexit happened, there's political and economic uncertainty, and rather than the government stepping in and saying, you know, how do we want to rebalance this economy that is so skewed towards an oversized financial sector and housing bubbles to one that's more balanced and fairer, we had the Bank of England stepping in and saying, we need to do more QE. And, you know, President Money isn't naive enough to say that we didn't necessarily need QE back in 2009. It could have been the best tool we had available in a hurry, and the financial crisis could have got worse without it. But we all know, and many, many economists are saying, like, it isn't good enough. It increases inequality. And yet we've just done it again. So the Bank of England is committed to creating £70 billion. We know it's going to increase inequality, but actually £10 billion of those pounds, good British pounds, are going to be going to some of these people. So there's a thing called corporate QE. So £10 billion isn't going to be buying government bonds from financial institutions. It's going to be buying corporate bonds. And the Bank of England just announced a couple of weeks ago the companies that are eligible, which are meant to be contributing a material amount to the UK economy. So we're quite surprised when we saw on the list companies like Apple, who have just been fined, I think, £11 billion by the EU for some kind of tax illegal stuff. Imperial Tobacco Company was on there, GlaxoSmithKline, BAE Systems, and many, many more. And even a former Monetary Policy Committee member, David Blanchflower, who was leading the Labour Party's review of the Bank of England, has said, you know, how can the bank be able to do this? It's unmandated fiscal policy. And many other people have said, you know, it can't be picking and choosing the companies and corporations to buy bonds in. That is, a mandated fiscal policy. And so, you know, we're trying to create some noise around this and say this isn't good enough. You know, we know there's a lot of different problems, but this is making things worse. And there is an alternative, which is gaining traction. So the alternative, well, there's a kind of a couple of alternatives, and they come under many different names, but you've hopefully heard of something called People's QE, maybe. So it kind of became a bit famous last summer when somebody called Richard Murphy was working with Jeremy Corbyn and started advocating it. And essentially, there's many different economists which have come up with similar proposals. The kind of geeky term for this stuff is monetary financing. The idea is that the Bank of England can create money in the public interest. That's good, but it can't pick where to put it. That should be the decision of the government, democratically elected. And they could be spending it on public investment that we very much need. Or there's another idea where we have some kind of citizens' fund where the money is simply divided by people and given to people. And the idea is if you have debt, you can kind of pay that off, and it's a bit like a debt jubilee. And if you don't have debt, you can use it to spend, and that will boost demand. And so there's kind of two broad ideas which are gaining traction. The public investment one is also known as people's QE or green QE, or even monetary financing of fiscal deficits, really sexy one, that one. And the Citizens Fund is known as helicopter money or monetary finance cash transfers. But these ideas, although they might sound kind of radical, actually many, many kind of mainstream economists, as well as radical economists, have supported them in the last couple of years. So Lauderdale Turner, who's chairman of the FSA, he's like really going around the country saying we need to start doing monetary financing. There's so much debt. We need to get it out of the private sector, the public sector. We can't just keep moving around all this debt. We need to get rid of it through monetary financing. Ben Bernanke, former chair of the Fed in the time of financial crash, he thinks that we should do it. And then some people might be more familiar with Yanis Varoufakis. He was almost on our panel earlier today. He's really in favour of doing it and in the Eurozone. Paul Mason, who was on our panel earlier, was talking about monetary financing and this need for monetary and fiscal policy to be working together. Okay, so the good idea about this is it would boost incomes, would allow people to pay down debt, would increase the capacity of the government to spend, and you know it should do the things that we want it to do. I could run through those, but I'll just keep going. Yeah. Yeah.
debt, or whether they, that, like, for example, they've got housing crisis, or if it's a woman who's, like, got undergone domestic violence, she needs to get out, it's distributed to her, or it's distributed to refugees, or it's distributed to somebody who's in debt, so the debts have to be cleared. Because one of the foundation things of our sort of faith, if you like, and I don't want to keep harping on about it, but it's just, I'm just interested how it links, is that we have to clear, we as a community are encouraged to clear people's debts. And the other thing I wanted to ask you is, you know, when you talked about the banks and how they buy assets, what the banks have done is that because they run on an IOU system, and originally the IOU was supposed to cover the gold reserves, because they haven't got enough gold reserves to cover the amount of IOUs now that are circulating in the UK,
yeah,
they've now turned the buildings, which is something that's essential that people can't live without, into the equivalent of a gold reserve. And this is, you know, this is where people are, you know, it's leading people into great difficulty buying the houses, because the house, if I went and built a house, bought a plot of land and built a house, I could build a very big house for a lot less than if I went to buy a house that was ready-made. Everything else that we buy loses its value unless you buy, like, a designer thing, and we go back to then, like, somebody else would, like, it depends on what somebody values something as. But everything, generally speaking, when we buy something, immediately it's already lost its value. But a building doesn't, and this is, they've turned the building into a gold reserve. Basically, that's what they've done.
Okay, as, yeah. Can we keep going? Can I feel like this, we might get stuck in a kind of money, gold, and... Okay, go for it. It gives me a break.
Yeah, so in terms of, I think there's another monetary policy which is worth considering, which I don't know if you have mentioned yet, is this idea, I suppose, of oxidizing money, having money which decreases in value over time. And you can either do this, I suppose, through negative interest rates, or you could potentially do this, we might have the technology to do this through digital currencies and having this done digitally. Because, as you said, any other commodity over a period of time loses its value. Money is one of the few ones which doesn't lose value over time. So there is a potential to, if we want to alleviate concentrations of money and inequality, do we think that could be a solution? And is that something many policymakers are thinking about? I haven't heard much. And also to go back to what you said about this being something which 1,400 years ago. Yeah, I would say it goes back even further. I mean, you go back to Mesopotamia, and you saw, like, debt jubilees, which you referenced before. And in ancient societies, every, 50 years or so, debts would be wiped clean because of the societal problems caused by debt and the inequality it causes.
Yeah. Okay, I'm just going to respond to those two points, and then I'm going to keep going. But I think, again, we're kind of conflating the wealth and money a little bit. We're talking about money being a store of value. And I think that, so kind of the main three things that most people agree on that money does is, like, it's a means of exchange, it's a unit of account, and it's a store of value. And I think it's really important that there are different points of view, but I think positive money's angle is, like, at its essence, it's most useful as a means of payment, as a means of exchange, and not as a store of value. And we can get a bit sucked in if we start thinking it has to be a store of value, because then it stops being a tool. And I try to kind of do the story of money through history, because I think that's really important. It's like, most of us aren't lucky enough to have savings. Like, if you look at the UK savings, like, it's pretty low. It's actually, like, depleted over the last 5 years. It's 4% or something like that. So most of us just need it as a means of exchange and as a means of payment. And we're not too worried about how much a pound is now relative to how much a pound was, like, a few years ago. We're worried about whether we can put food on the table, pay our rent, and get by. And I think that that's, like, what we're trying to have this conversation about these reforms is that we can actually separate money as a means of payment and the payment system being a public good from the kind of credit, debt, store of value, investment side. And I know that's like me just throwing a whole load of things in together, but I think it's quite important for people not to kind of think of money as being as important as a store of value, because I think that's kind of, yeah, that's just our point of view. So I'll stop talking there. And we've got plenty more time for discussion. It's only six. So I'm just going to briefly talk about our campaign, then I'm going to get you to split into groups, and then come back and comments and questions, and then Charith's going to talk about momentum economy for a little bit. So how do we make this happen? Like, our sense, there's just a few of us in the Positive Money office, but we've got a massive network across the UK, and we're connected to other campaigns across the world. And we've seen this debate go from nothing when we were founded 6 years ago, when basically everyone was like, what? Banks create money out of nothing? Like, what are you talking about? Go away. Like, you're weird. To actual mainstream economists talking about banks creating money and it's a problem, and QE being undemocratic and untransparent. So we feel like it might not seem to most people that it's going to happen, but we think we're heading in this direction. So when the Bank of England announced more QE in August, then we were like, okay, we've got to do something. So we launched a campaign. Again, the name isn't great, but bear with me. We're going for create money for people, not financial markets. And the idea is that we want to say no to QE, no to corporate QE, and we want to see money entering the real economy through one of those two ways I talked about, like a citizens' fund where money is created and just given to people, or spent on public infrastructure and investment that we just so desperately need. Could fund John McDonnell's $500 billion that he pledged yesterday, or whatever it was. So we got 35 economists to write a letter to Philip Hammond on the day it was announced, saying that they don't agree with this policy. We shouldn't be doing it. Philip Hammond, the Chancellor, has the power to say yes to QE or to say no, and to give the Bank of England new tools. So more economists are getting behind it. And we started a petition. We've got over 6,000 signatures, and we're hoping to get more over the next few months, when every single month the Bank of England is creating money. It's not doing it $70 billion all at once. There was a debate in Parliament, which was very timely, on the 15th of September, where MP spoke. Helen Goodman's the Labour MP that sits on the Treasury Select Committee, and the Treasury Select Committee is really the only group of MPs that scrutinises the Bank of England in any substantial way. And she was pointing to in that debate the fact that the Bank of England's QE increases inequality, and it's pretty alarming. And so we're trying to work with our local groups across the country to meet with their MPs. You know, Helen Goodman is basically a lone voice in Labour, criticising monetary policy at the moment. We're trying to get more of them, and we're doing that through our local groups network. And we've got 30 groups, a few people here today from Positive Money local groups, because, you know, as always, if we don't start talking about it, nobody will, and it's not really good enough that we've basically got the same financial system we had in 2008 when it crashed. So we're going to be running a day of action on the 4th of November, which is the next big Monetary Policy Committee meeting. And we really hope that you can sign up to our mailing list so we can give you more information about that. So, but I think if there are any quick questions for anything I've said, I'll take them. And then we'll move into groups and where it's basically open space to just chat about what you want to, but I'd ask you to think about, like, what struck you in the conversations, what are you confused about, what do you need more clarity on, and then come back and ask questions and comments. So there's about, point of information.
So there's 31 groups. Okay. There is a Liverpool group who meets in Silvestrian last Wednesday of the month. So that's the first bit. Second bit, we are also trying to establish a bank which would be along the lines of a public bank, which would invest within the region, along the lines of Positive Money, So there's quite a bit of work getting on. We've also worked with other local groups, and we will be going to a meeting in a short period of time to forward our proposals on the public bank.
What's your name?
John Dolby, that's your name. Tell them your name.
My name is John Dolby,
6:30, last Wednesday of the month, at Sylvester Street Community Centre.
Great.
Yeah, everybody's welcome.
And you can ask them more questions later on about Liverpool Group. So, are these specific questions on stuff I've said?
Great. How does Positive Money's campaign relate to John McDonald's suggestion for National Investment Bank, and how far have the discussion progressed?
Yeah, I can quickly answer that. So we're really focused on money. As you can tell from the conversation today, it's a really big topic. But we know that the current banks we have, private commercial banks, even if we take away their power to create money, we're unlikely to see them turning around and deciding to lend into the things we need. So we believe in a need for new types of banks, and Adair Turner has actually really good on this, as of the New Economics Foundation. But we're specifically focusing our energy on monetary policy and the monetary system, and that's big enough for now. So informally we'd say yes, it's a great idea, but it's not something that we're campaigning for, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a quick comment about the gentleman that spoke earlier about the value of money. It should oxidize, it should decrease. And I just wanted to let him know that it does, and it's called inflation. That's all I wanted to say.
Unfortunately, that's
exactly
what I was going to say.
Great.
I'm sorry. If you increase the money supply, which is what QE is doing, and you don't increase the amount of goods and value that you're producing in the economy, the end result has got to be inflation. It might be postponed because of pressures holding down wages and so on at the moment, but it must eventually hit us. And that's something you haven't mentioned at all.
Just going to respond to that, and then I feel like we might want to break out. Basically, inflation is like used all the time, and it means the increase of a price of something over time. But it's really frustrating because everything has different rates of inflation, basically. So CPI, the Consumer Price Index, is what the Bank of England uses when they talk about their target of 2%. It's basically a basket of goods, like beans or milk, but it doesn't include what is our biggest cost, which is rent or mortgage repayments, which is house prices. House price inflation has been getting out of control.
I just have a really quick question. I wanted to ask about whether you think that Positive Money, I know it would be very ambitious, could think about it on a European level. And I was wondering, given QE is so often discussed in the context of the Eurozone, whether those types of solutions are better organized on a state level, or could potentially work better on like the European Union level. I'm personally a migrant from Europe, so maybe that's why I think about it in this way, but just generally, whether you think it's realistic that this could be, rather than a state mandated strategy, that you know the European Central Bank could also engage in something like this, and if it could work like that.
Okay, I have to admit to feeling quite confused about what I'm hearing here, because I come from an economics background that says it's not so much a problem what the government is doing with monetary policy, so much as the fact that its fiscal policy is not at all supportive. So on the one hand, it's trying to be expansionary in its monetary policy, which is why we have interest rates unprecedentedly low, but because at the same time we have an austerity program which is cutting back on demand in terms of public investment, public expenditure, and we have extremely low wage level at the base, which reduces consumption. And the effect of all of that is that we have a contractionary level of demand, or contractionary fiscal policy, at the same time as we're trying to use monetary policy to be expansionary. And the main problem with that is that the areas of the economy that we want to be profitable, the areas that would provide wages and incomes and growth for the population, are not yielding a profit, because there's no sustainable general national market demand. And that's our fundamental problem. So for me, money as an issue, I see it as a lubricant in the same way that a car needs oil for all the parts to run well. We need an economy where the monetary system is functioning well, and it needs to sort of be in the background, and we need our fiscal, our level of demand, to be in the foreground, and that's the fundamental problem. So we need regulations on the money supply so that that system is stable and strong and isn't a problem. And then we need appropriate fiscal policy, and we need subsidies in the areas where they will provide jobs and incomes and future growth, future investment. That's where our problem lies.
Okay, thank you. I'll answer all of those quickly, and then we're going to break into groups. So I really agree with you that I didn't mention the like psychological as a massive issue with on a societal level and cultural level and on the individual level, what is our relationship to money, and everyone has a really So it's like, how do we heal that relationship? We're addicted to the emotions is the way you describe it. And I think that that's definitely something that I think about, and it's something that many people involved in the movement think about. It's a really difficult conversation to bring up, because actually most people's relationship with money isn't a good one. Yeah, exactly. But we're very British and we hate talking about money. So it could also be why it's such a taboo. But I think it's a really important point, and I guess I was trying to hint at it with the kind of, you know, it's like fish is the last in the water. We kind of don't even realise this relationship we have with money, and that's almost like the first stage. EU level, yes, we are running it. Well, we started a campaign called QE for People in the Eurozone, which is QE for the number people.eu, and we've got a coalition of 20 civil society organisations from across Europe and over 100 economists from across Europe supporting it, and it's actually getting a lot of traction. People at the top level, Draghi's like right-hand men, left-hand men, are talking about it, and they're kind of denying they're talking about it, but we know they're talking about it. And we know that they're considering it because, the conversation is happening quite fast, and I think it could happen on any level. It would probably be the citizens' dividend, like the helicopter money. But if you want to talk more about it, come and talk to me, because it's really exciting. And I think, so on the last point, I'm just going to like summarise an answer, which might not be satisfying, but basically I felt like you were saying, if we stopped austerity and we started fiscal expansion, then QE would be fine. And our point is like, no, it still wouldn't be okay. And I think the point is where we're directing money, like we'd still be increasing inequality. Even if we were expanding government spending, QE would still be going into the financial markets, and it would still be going into property markets. And that's the kind of point, is like, that we're trying to get this conversation going in Labour. Like, obviously we know we don't want austerity, we need fiscal expansion. But if we're ever going to move to an economy that is not skewed towards property and financial markets, that is rebalanced, we need monetary policy to stop basically serving those markets and to start serving the real economy. Direction money and credit into those markets. And I think part of the problems with neoclassical economics, which is the main school of economics which is currently taught, is that it talks about money as a neutral veil, basically, that kind of is like a lubricant and that just flows, like oils the wheels. But actually, the point is it's lost the understanding that money is created at a source, whether that's like the pounds and coins or the QE by the Bank of England, or the commercial banks lending into mortgages. And that is a power, and that is a source, and that is a direction. That's direct, meaning our economy is skewed in a direction. And that's what we're trying to say, is like, we can't actually really have a socially just economy without monetary policy working with fiscal policy, and without really considering what the role of a central bank is, if that makes sense. So I'm going to leave it there, because we still want to hear from Charith. So I'd really like you to break into groups of like 3 to 4 and just have a 5 to 10 minute discussion about some of these issues that have come up for you, and then we're going to come back and hear from Momentum Economy, and then we're going to wrap up with any more questions. And so I'd invite you to talk about, like, what struck you, what are you confused about, what do you need more clarity on, and then maybe feedback, a comment and a question to the rest of the group. So you've got 7 minutes.
Yeah. Thank you.
that's good. Okay, we are rapidly running out of time, and I'd like Charith to get a chance to talk to you about momentum economy, which is bringing radical ideas on economics into the momentum community. But I think it'd be great to hear from each group. I hope that you're having interesting conversations, because that's what it's all about. To give comments or if questions, then concise questions. So can I get maybe seven hands if people are going to feedback from their group, and then I'll just work my way through you all. So we've got two here, three. Who from this side is going to feedback? Four. Just so you know, there's going to be not any more chance to put up your hands. Five. And then one from down here. Would anyone like to feedback from this group? Okay, six. Okay, so we're going to move across the room.
Hello. So one of the things we were talking about, my name's Andrew, he said my name, that's my name, was that in a way to getting away, as you said earlier, about thinking of money as just as a store of value, but more as a sort of a medium of exchange. We thought the point is that if you understand economic activity, really it's a flow, right? So if I spend £10, which then, you know, goes somewhere else, and so at the end of the year when we talk about, you know, what was, you know, the size of our economy, we're not talking about how many £10 notes there are or what happens if you sum up all the bank accounts. We're talking about how many times did money change hands, really. And so one of the issues with quantitative easing in its current form is that we're injecting money into places with, you know, very low velocity, particularly in the housing market. You know, in general, what's happening is we're inflating the price of houses that already exist, and when people are moving houses and selling houses, on the whole, that money is just going into another house. So actually, there's almost no chance for that money to escape into the economy at large. And so this is really about injecting money where it's going to move around and where it will benefit the most people and really stimulate the economy, as opposed to just sitting around in house prices.
Great point.
I think our conclusion was that if the Bank of England can use QE and then we democratically tell the Bank of England what to spend it on, then it effectively makes Gordon Brown's letter to the Prime Minister that we've got no money as a little bit of nonsense. And if so, if the government does have QE as a tool to spend on any service that it wishes to, then what's the purpose of tax?
Good question. Maybe tax creates the value of money because we all have a national currency to pay taxes. But that's a big one.
Okay, so we talked briefly at the beginning about negative interest rates and what they're doing and whether this is good or not. I'm trying to work that out. And then we talked about... we were very disturbed about the kind of corporate quantitative easing, particularly. Oh, particularly, it's better, isn't it? So we talked about negative interest rates and how confusing they are, and we were very disturbed by corporate quantitative easing, particularly Imperial Tobacco and BAE Systems. And we were talking about the role of the media in perhaps not drawing people's attention to this. And someone mentioned that there's a headline on the Express, was it, that Labour is in la-la land because they are suggesting spending money on certain things, and yet actually when you look at what actually is happening, that's the real la-la land, the kind of crazy quantitative easing that you've talked about. And so I guess we're talking about the role of the media indirectly through the discussions.
Great, and we're going to move over to these three. Yeah.
One thing our group really appreciated is the presentation and the discussions, because it's something that isn't easily accessible, this kind of information. And I was also saying that at university and college, so in total having studied 4 years of economics, you never talk about this. Monetary policy is always sort of at the back of the book, and you, a bit bizarre, and you don't really touch it. The other thing we were talking about is how mortgages and lending has changed a lot over the years. I don't have as many years as as my teammates, but they were saying that it's become a lot more individualized, and this idea of control and this idea of being tied into something that you're not quite sure what it is has become part of this whole lending casino economy. And yeah, I think that's the main things. Yeah.
We had, well, quite a meandering conversation, but kind of ended up talking about how, you know, the problems with banks essentially controlling monetary policy, and how this happens because of the very close relationship between banks and the financial sector and the government, and how this reinforces the bank's ability to create money. And we start talking about how it would be better to, you know, if we could democratize this by having credit unions and local banks, which people have more direct control over than, say, a national monetary policy, how this would be much more transparent if it could benefit from people's quantitative easing as well as just a national fund.
Well, we're Monty Python fans, so we talked about something completely different. But it does relate to helicopter money. There is a precedent in this country for doing this kind of exercise at a smaller level. The previous Labour government did, through the credit unions, organise something called the Growth Fund, which gave credit unions money to lend to people on benefits. It was quite a big pot, and most credit unions in the country took it up. They then did an assessment. Part of the giving the money was to give an assessment afterwards. So this was government money given to people. They had to pay it back, asked to pay it back. They did the assessment, and at the end of the program, over 30% of the people who'd received a loan through this scheme were able to articulate specifically how it had improved and changed their lives. It made a real difference. Of course, the coalition didn't carry it on.
Great, thank you. A really amazing amount of conversations that have happened and amount of topics we've covered. So just want to leave you with one thought, which is something that Yanis Varoufakis has said recently on negative interest rates. He described it as a technocratic fix to a problem crying out for a philosophically astute political solution, calling for a new perspective on money. And I think that that can be applied to QE, to the low interest rates, and to the state of the money system. And so thank you very much for being here. I'm just going to hand over to Charith, who's going to talk about momentum economy. Thanks.
Hi, thank you, Fran. My name is Charith Gunawardena. I'm a member of the Labour Party, but also a supporter of positive money. And I think, like Fran said, during the last Labour leadership elections, I suddenly heard there was a lot of conversations happening which we hadn't quite heard before. And then while I was searching around websites to learn a little bit more, I came across the Positive Money website. And I was quite interested to suddenly find out about these issues about money. And that just got me looking around a lot more, trying to learn for myself more about the money side. I have an engineering background, and I have not really anything to do with economics or accountancy or anything like that. And it's been quite a struggle to try and learn the information and find the right type of information to get a good grasp of, or at least a basic understanding of what the economy is all about. So what I've tried to do is, over the last few months, just collect the information which I have been getting and putting into some structure. I just call it momentum economy because there's a lot of enthusiasm in the group Momentum. It's not fully affiliated to Momentum. So I didn't even have time to get it cleared, so I've told them I'm going to present this here, and it's not an approved website or anything like that from Momentum. But certainly the ideas are not to try and do anything against what the party or Momentum was saying. It's just to try and create a discussion and give a resource pool for people to sort of access. This is a work in progress. I haven't fully finished this, but the aim is really trying to say we are talking about making money work for people, right? So there is a lot of discussion that happened about money being created for banks. And, oops, I think I might have to switch to a presentation. It's, yeah, so we spoke a lot about making money work for people, and it's important to know who are we talking about. So, for example, if you talk about the 99%, right? It is the small businesses, entrepreneurs, self-employed, public sector workers. All of them have certain needs and issues that need to be sorted out. And how does the money actually work for each of those groups? And if you really try to look at the issues about money, in the end, it's really about the long-term interest of the people rather than the short-termism. And I think each of those groups of people, there are certain things you can break it down into. We all have certain rights, right? So if you take something like, we expect as a public certain levels of public services, so whether it's housing, education, health, social services. And if you are able to articulate the basic needs, and I'm sure most of the people, whether you're left, right, center, if you talk about housing, we will all probably can align with affordable housing, access to social housing, rent control, secure tenancies, quite a lot of ideas. There could be a lot of consensus. And for each of these areas, we would be saying we can agree on things like public services. We all want level playing fields. If you're a small business, you don't want to be unnecessarily under competition against big corporations who don't pay same levels of taxes or have their different levels of ways of getting advantages. So we could also say that in terms of opportunities, there has to be certain levels of ways of fulfilling our potentials, whether it's a small business or individuals. And I think the website, I'm trying to cover most of the core issues where you can try and understand various issues like this. Now, there are certain things that are blocking these rights to be delivered. And I think one of the issues we were talking about is the money creation side, the concepts of money. If you take any individual, we spoke about trickle-down economics, money coming to us in a very strong way. But the money certainly gushes away from us much faster than it trickles down, right? And if you really think about it, it goes away from us as interest payments, right? It goes away from us as rent. Yeah, it goes away from us due to tax injustice. We are just paying stuff out. Is it in a really fair way? And finally, I'm also talking about things like pricing distortions. So when you have utility companies, money, big systems, if there isn't real right levels of competition, there is a certain way of money going out because of the pricing distortions. So I bet each one of you will have money gushing out in all these forms, right? And I think it's fairly important to really start understanding and questioning these points. I'm not saying there are solutions, but it's really understanding what is rent, what is earned income versus unearned income. And once you can get this type of ideas and get an understanding, then you'll be able to communicate when you do your activism or your communication. We all need to generate a basic level of knowledge. And so what I'm hoping to do is to put some ideas and put useful references where people can get that, generate that knowledge. Now, once you understand the rights you have, which we all have, you really know the barriers that are blocking these things. There are certain reforms that are needed to make the changes happen. And I think yesterday's speech by the Shadow Chancellor was giving some of the changes they're proposing. There are quite radical things. There are a lot of other discussions happening in the other fringe meetings and workshops here. it's not an easy task to change the whole system, but it's very important that the debates happen. Whether you agree with them or don't agree, it doesn't matter. And what we don't have is have easy access to the information. And so certainly what you're trying to do, if you talk about things like money, universal basic incomes, there are different ways of tax revenues like land value taxes, Robin Hood taxes. There are loads of ideas which are very nice things out there. And we are trying to put all that information together so people have knowledge which they can have. And finally, this topic of economics, it's really not talking about everything which the real economy happens. We had a contribution earlier which they are saying even in the universities today, all these points are not discussed in a certain way. There are many good not-for-profit organizations, think tanks, who are doing some really good work trying to bring this knowledge out there, but without having access to the media, the broadcasters, and not really having money to get those messages out, it doesn't give us a chance to really learn what happens. So what I'm just trying to do is to put a resource information pool for everyone to share. Certainly, it's work in progress. All the content is not up there. That's why I didn't have a time to fully get approved by Momentum. But if anyone takes a look and wants to go through the stuff, certainly feel free to send an email or a follow on Twitter or something. And certainly feel free to share amongst all your colleagues and try to build a good resource pool for everyone.
I think we're totally out of time, but just to say, yeah, I mean, the idea is that we want to have these discussions about radical new economics ideas. So I just want to, can we just all thank ourselves for coming, and I hope you have a great rest of the conference, etc. And then one more. There is a list going around if anyone hasn't left their email for either Positive Money or Momentum Economy. So please, who's got the list? Oh, it's Dan.